Hey guys, what's up? This is Shot Science Overtime number 74. Today we're going to do our typical Sunday show where we have a topic that we discuss for the first 15 or so minutes while you guys send us questions. You can send those questions to us at Shot Science on Twitter. It's the best place to reach us. Or you can put them in the chat of this video on YouTube, or you can send them to us in the Q&A app on Google+. Even Facebook is a good place to catch us, but the best place is on Twitter. So tweet us at Shot Science. And we'll try to ask your question on the show. You typically get to most all the Twitter questions, and we shout you out when we say them. So definitely do that. Go out, tell your friends to show up for the show, because that helps us have more great guests on, and some other people too. So make sure you go out there and tell everybody to show up. We're going to talk about our discussion topic first, then we're going to answer your questions for the rest of the time. So make sure you send us those questions. Go tell people. All right. So our topic for today is the top three things that will speed up your shot. And before we do that, I just want to let you know that I'm Casey, this is Chase, and this is Coach Tom, and we are Shot Science Basketball. I guess we'll start with the one thing that will help you speed up your shot. And what might one of those things
be? Probably one of the things that's most critical as far as we're concerned is how we use our feet and get into the shot. And we like to use the 1-2 type of footwork where if we're coming from the left side, we want to step and make our contact with the floor with the left foot first and then bring the right around to shoot. And this allows us to address the basket really effectively. One thing that we do not feel is really the best way to go is to hop into the shot or was another word that I often hear, but it doesn't come to my mind right now. But we don't want to hop into the shot because we don't feel, number one, like you have balance. And we often hear that it is it's much quicker than using the 1-2.
Now, but it is not.
But we don't feel like it is. And we can talk more about that as we kind of go along. But the thing that's really important for us is that we get that footwork down so that we're on balance and we're ready to deliver the ball as soon as we get the opening. Oftentimes that little bounce in there takes too long and we're not on balance. And so our shot then is not going to be very effective. So,
Well, here's the thing about the 1-2. A lot of people think that it's a slow down thing where you have to do it so that it's methodical and you'll be able to stop your momentum and stuff like that. But that's not what it is at all. It is full speed. You're not planting one foot and then picking up the other foot and just it's not a step so much as it's how the feet land. It's 1-2, and you're using that first foot as a stop foot, so that's going to stop your forward momentum, and then you're using your trail foot as kind of the way to bring your feet together and use that to gain power as you go up into your shot. And you know, people are saying that it's slower and you have to do that, but that's obviously because they don't understand the mechanics of it. And if you look at like Olympic high jumpers or something, they're using that same footwork, that 1-2 explosive footwork. And the other reason why that is so much quicker is because you are stepping into the pass or the dribble and you're taking care of the footwork and generating rhythm before you even really go up into the shot.
Yeah, that's a really big point. The fact that, often people, when they talk about the 1-2, I think they figure that it's delayed. You pick up the ball and then you go 1-2. But the way we teach it, and we think this is really an effective way to go because it develops so much rhythm for the shot as well as getting rid of the ball a little quicker without forcing the shot too quickly, is that even before we've got that last dribble down, that foot is already getting itself set. And as the dribble comes up, and we always teach our students too to really pound that last dribble. We want it to come back to our hands really quick. So as all of that is happening, that first foot is set, and then the other foot comes around very quickly. So we don't have that up and down and up again that you get when you're hopping into the shot. And probably the most important thing in all of that, though, for my money, is that you're on balance. If you're hopping, oftentimes you don't have that balance, and your body's moving forward or to the rear or right or left. And when that's the case, your accuracy is going to be offline. Chase, got anything on that?
No, I mean, I think the most important thing is that when you hop into a shot, you fully committed to it.
Exactly.
That's probably the biggest downside of it is you can't react to how the defender is playing. You've committed completely to that move. Whether it's slower or quicker, it's much more about committing to that move and the defender being able to lock in on exactly what you're doing. Whereas if it's 1-2, you have the opportunity to counter or react and change the move if they overcommit. So that's probably the biggest benefit of it.
Right. That's one of the things I think is really important, because if that defender is in the way, you have a situation where you can counter the opposite direction or you can step back. If you hop into the shot, like Chase says, you are committed. You have no choice. You either got to deliver the ball to the basket or you got to end up giving it to someone else.
And, you know, like you said, you kind of glossed over it, but the whole high, low, high thing is really important to me, because you know, I think there's like an old basketball adage that always says, like, the person that's lowest always wins. And it's all about like leverage and kind of having mobility and directionality. And when you think about stepping into the shot 1-2, you have to stay low to do that. And so you're going from a low to a high, which is the high is the shot. When you hop, you have to commit to going up into the air, even if it's a small amount. So you're jumping, it's going to be high, low, and then back to high. So you're creating this extra thing that doesn't need to be there. It's an extra variable. You can eliminate that and be more efficient. So 1-2 is going to be more efficient. It's going to give you more options. It's going to be more on balance. It's going to be faster. It's going to be more explosive. The list goes on. So that's the reason why we like that and we teach that.
Right.
People that don't like it, I think they tend to not understand the actual mechanics of it. Okay.
Right.
Stop. Next one.
Okay. Next one is making sure that we have a nice, clean a shot where we're not dipping the ball, because when we bring the ball into our body, and, you know, we have a video on this, and I think an awful lot of people misunderstand what is going on in that video. What we want to do is not take the ball and bring it down in front of our body in that zone where it can be knocked away or contested, and then bring it up through that to get ready to shoot. That takes a long time. Now, you take when I say it takes a long time, it probably takes the better second half to dip that ball down, depending on how deep you dip it.
Well, not a second and a half, but
and then bring it up to shoot it. So that too much time is elapsed there, and you can't get the ball away. One of the things that I think is really important too is that when you get that ball and it's in the up rhythm, one of the things that happens is that you get that shot, the clean shot, open before that guy can really contest. Now, one of the things, and I'm just going to mention this to Chase and about Chase, and then he can kind of speak to it as well. One of the things that I always liked about his shot is the fact that he was able to get rid of it very quickly without rushing it. And that's the other thing that we probably should mention here, is rushing your shot is going to make you very ineffective. But if you're efficient in getting the ball off, getting it to your set point and delivering the ball, that's going to really work to your advantage. Chase, you got any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a good point about rushing your shot. I think you want to really focus in on the mechanics and get those down, and then slowly you can speed your shot up over time and find where kind of that happy medium is of being able to catch and release. I think probably sometimes you get too quick of a release trying to push it to that end, but you find that kind of nice spot once you've really fine-tuned a lot of the mechanics where you're not dipping the ball, you can catch and you're already up into your movement, and that's where you're going to get the speed off the shot, not the quicker release or push of the ball trying to get it out of your hands.
Right.
Right. And, you know, the thing about it is that when you're trying to put your shot together, you should work towards making it the most efficient machine that you possibly can. So that means eliminating all the variables, because if you have variables, those are areas that can go wrong. They're much more harder or much more difficult to repeat. And so if your repeatability starts to drop off, your accuracy starts to drop off. So you just want to eliminate all the unnecessary movements. The dip is a major unnecessary movement where you're bringing the ball down and back up. You don't need to do that, because the only reason that you do that is to generate rhythm. And it's a rhythm generator. And if people are telling you, oh, it helps you generate power and all this stuff, if it does, which it doesn't really, it's very minimal. Yeah. And, you know, you're bringing it down through this area where the defender's hands are going to be, and you're also doing this extra movement where things can go wrong. And if you're using your feet to generate the rhythm, like we teach with the 1-2, you don't need to have any extra rhythm generator. That will help you do that, and you've taken care of it essentially before you've even caught the ball.
Right.
And so you can eliminate things like the dip, and you don't need them, so your shot will be that much faster and will have a lot less areas where things can go wrong and you won't be able to have an accurate shot.
Well, and a lot of people contact me and they kind of say, well, if you're dipping the basketball, this is going to give you more power. Minimal, probably, because, you know, when we take a look at where the power base is when we shoot a basketball, it's not our arms and shoulders, unless you're built like Dwight Howard or somebody like that, where you've got this massive chest and shoulder and whatnot, where they can probably hang for half an hour and then shoot the ball. I'm just kidding about that.
But even then, it's not efficient.
It's not efficient. And the thing that's really important for you to remember is to take and not have all these extra motions. Now, a comment that comes to us all the time, well, all the great shooters in the NBA do that. Well, some of them do it sometimes. But the guys that you see that dip the ball oftentimes don't dip it at all when they're coming into the catch and shoot.
They do it from a standstill.
They do it when their feet are planted and stand still. And so then what they do is they take use that as their rhythm generator. And that takes time. And the other thing is this, the ball is exposed to the defense, as Casey was talking a while ago. Anytime you take it down to your waist or some people I've seen even lower than that, and then bring it back up, that's where their hands are going to be able to get a hand on that ball.
And it's not a magic pill. A lot of people think it is, but it's not.
No.
And the thing about it is that you want to just be as efficient as possible.
Yep.
And it's not efficient.
Right.
Okay, so the next thing is connectivity. You know, a lot of people try to have these quick shots and they have like these herky-jerky movements in it. And every time you have a sticking point like that, it's going to be slower and it's going to have you lose power. And when you do that, obviously being slower is going to make it harder for you to get the shot off if it's contested. And if you lose power, I mean, you're probably going to have a tough time, A, getting the ball to the basket, and B, judging how much energy to put into the shot.
Right.
And so what you want to do is try to eliminate all those sticking points. You know, if you come up and you stop here, and then you come up here and you stop, and, you know, you have all these motions where you're stopping your upward motion or whatever, you want to try to eliminate those. Look at somebody like Steph Curry or even Klay Thompson. Those guys have just super fluid shots that start from their feet, and it, you know, as they pick the ball up, it all goes up in one smooth motion. There's no sticking points.
Right.
Right?
Yes. And, you know, the thing that happens, too, is that people don't really think about the importance of the lower legs. Some people say, well, all the power comes from the shoulders. It doesn't. Whenever you take a look at how power is allocated to us when we shoot a basketball, there's probably about 15 or 20% of the total power that we generate as a shooter that comes from our shoulders and our upper body. The rest of it comes from our core muscle group, which is right in the middle of our body, and then the muscles of the lower body, such as the gluteus or your butt, and then the quads and hamstrings, and finally the muscles of your lower leg, your calves. And so those generate way more power because they're larger muscles. And so that's where our power really comes. And saying that you're going to get more power if you're bringing the ball up and that from that dipping motion, and it isn't that in the truth. You might get a little, very minimal.
I'm going to say one more thing before we move on. But, you know, the thing is that you want to rush your feet, not your finish, because your finish or your most of the stuff you're doing with your upper body needs to be the finesse part of the shot.
Right.
Because if you're trying to muscle any part of that, then you're going to lose your accuracy and your repeatability because you're trying to brute it in. But if you are getting all of your power and kind of the muscle part of your shot from the lower body, then you're going to be able to have a more refined, kind of accurate motion up top when you're shooting the ball.
Well, one of the reasons that you have that accuracy is that oftentimes when we are getting ready to release the ball, even before we release it, we know it's underpowered. We can feel it. And that's something that we really stress with our students, is the fact that you can feel that the ball is going to be underpowered. And what we almost always do is yank the shoulders to try and make up for that. And when we do that, then accuracy just goes nuts.
Right.
And so what we want to do is use those legs, get up in the air, and then right at the end we're delivering very smoothly. Now, there was an article I read some time ago now. I don't remember who it was from, but I really like the way that they put this. And that they said, okay, the arms and shoulders and the eyes and brain and all that are really the guidance system. They guide the basketball where it needs to go. And then the power base is everything that is from your midsection down to your feet. That's where the power comes from when we shoot it.
Right. Okay. So do we have any more comments on getting a quicker, faster shot or speeding up your shot? I think that's pretty good.
Yep,
good.
Okay, so what we're going to do now, you guys, thank you for sitting through that, and hopefully we helped you maybe speed up your shot a little bit, but in the right way so that you're not rushing your finish or anything. But what we're going to do now is we're going to transition into you guys sending us your questions. So if you haven't sent a question to us, now is the time, because we're going to start getting a bunch of questions and we want to get to as many people as possible. So you can tweet them to us. We are at Shot Science on Twitter. You can send them to us in the Q&A on Google+, and also you can send them to us in the chat on YouTube on this video. So if you want a question answered, now would be the time, because if you wait, I can guarantee it's going to be kind of a major rush at the very end to get as many in as we can. So now is the time. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to jump in and we're going to start on some of these questions. Let's see. This one is from Adelu Adedinji, something like that. If I butchered it, I apologize. But they ask, will a shoulder injury hinder the development of my shot?
Why don't you take that, Shish?
I mean, it's really hard to answer that. It really depends on the type of shoulder injury that it is. But I would say, I mean, it's just really impossible to say much on that. Probably depending on the point of your injury as well. I think you can work on a lot of the footwork stuff and building the foundation there, but it's really hard to make too much of a judgment without knowing what the shoulder injury is. Right. Although I would just be cautious in your return to movements of anything overhead, which a shot shooting the basketball is. So yeah. Focus on the lower body, footwork, get that stuff down, and then as your shoulder gets back to a point where it's not injured or you're, you know, pretty close to being fully recovered, you can get that release to shoot and work on more of the form stuff of the upper body.
How about that next one?
Yeah, with any injury, you don't want to rush, you know, getting back into things. You really want to make sure that you're healed up and ready to go. Okay, so this one is from Michael Zeldenrust. He says, hey, Shot Science, I'm 21 and I've been playing basketball for more than 13 years. I'm having trouble being more confident on the court since my ACL injury and recovery. I haven't really been the same. Do you have any tips? Love your podcast. Greets from Holland. Hey, what's going on?
That's great.
Yeah, so Chase probably has some thoughts on ACL injuries and recovery.
Yeah, I tore my ACL 3 years ago playing basketball. I think the biggest thing on that is just being diligent in your recovery and really focusing in on strengthening the muscles around the joint. So there's lots of exercises you should be doing from, you know, depending on the level of recovery and where you're at, but just really strengthening the hamstrings is one of the most important things you can do for that, because a lot of times we're so quad dominant. And then just working on flexibility of the joint, working on lots of isolation and stabilization exercises around the joint itself. But really, the exercises themselves are really not that much different than a lot of the stuff we're doing in the vertical jump handbook. Probably not a lot of the power exercises if you're still recovering from that, obviously. Not a lot of the impact ones. But the foam rolling, the engagement exercises, all of those things are things that you should be doing to help strengthen and stabilize that joint.
Does that include stretching, Chase?
Dynamic
stretches.
I would do less on the stretching in an injury recovery and focus more on stabilization of the joint, because what you don't want to do is increase the laxity of the joint by doing too much stretching when you haven't really worked on stabilizing the joint. So you want to work on the mechanics and getting those muscles stabilizing the joint really well, and then you can work on more of the stretching and flexibility. Not that you can't do a little bit of each throughout, but you don't want to really push the stretching. Focus more on the stability and stabilizing the joint.
Right. So you think that helps with like confidence building and stuff like that?
Yeah, it's just a matter of progressing back as you stabilize the joint more. And that goes back to the question, obviously, is really working on those isolated exercises to increase the muscle strength and stability, and then trying to translate that and progress back to more and more game-like situations. So you can't just run back into playing after sitting out for a year and not doing any rehab. You know, you really got to work on strengthening those exercises and getting back into the game. And just a quick note on the confidence stuff, those exercises right before you play is probably the most important time to really stabilize the joint, get it warmed up before you just run out on the court. So if you're fully recovered and you just kind of have this fear of the injury, work on doing a lot of those exercises beforehand, the hamstring engagement exercises, a lot of our vertical jump stuff right before you play.
Cool. And yes, and go spread the word in Holland, too, about Shot Science. That would be awesome. Okay, so let's go to Twitter. This one is from Nathan Thompson, who is at NateT_AF, who asks, I know how to score on big guys, but how do I defend them? They always just post me up when I'm playing one-on-one. Well, when you're playing one-on-one, that kind of puts you in a little bit of a disadvantage if they're doing that. when you're trying to defend big guys, I mean, you really just have to contest the shot, really.
Well, even more importantly for me is don't let them catch the ball.
Well, it's one-on-one.
Yeah, one-on-one, even so. Makes it a little more difficult. But
no, but there's lots of things with guarding a defender. I think really it's defining within your team structure, if it's not one-on-one, are you playing in front of them or behind them?
Exactly.
Letting them catch is probably the most important thing. If you're playing one-on-one, obviously he's already caught the ball or is going to be able to you know, get position on you. The best thing, best defensive advice always is keep him between your shoulders and stay lower than him.
Yeah.
You know, and the best thing you can do is contest the first shot and not let him get it back.
Mm-hmm.
So he's going to get a shot up. You get your hands up, you stay under control, you stay down, and then once he shoots it, you got to make sure you get contact and box him out so that the rebound's going to be yours. You can't get it back.
Well, one of the things that I think is real important, too, is that when he turns to face the basket, that you wall up on him right away.
Yeah.
And you wall up on him with both hands fully extended straight up so that you were not – if this was an officiated game, that you wouldn't be called for a foul. But if you take and wall up on him, one of the things that is really kind of intimidating is that if this person, even though they're shorter than you, if they've got both those hands extended and they're right up belly button to you, it's not as easy to shoot the basketball as you might think. The other thing that I think really comes into play in the one-on-one situation is try to figure out which is his strong side, and he'll want to turn that way if he's got his back to the basket, and if he's facing the basket, he's probably going to want to go to that side as well. Don't let him have that one. And I think what the guys were saying here about keeping him between your knees or between your shoulders is really important, because if he can't drive there and you wall up on him real quick when he picks the ball up, that should help you defensively.
Right. And, you know, the thing is that you don't want to find yourself reaching and trying to grab and snag at the ball. That's probably going to put you at the disadvantage.
Yeah.
Do the wall up. Make it just difficult for them to get the shot off. Okay. Here's another one from Nate. He says, what can I do to get better at court vision and get good looks from my teammates? I think for court vision, it really just it takes kind of some effort on your part to really just work on having your head up, analyzing the court as you're playing, and just doing that and being regimented about it. You don't want to lose that ability. You just want to be consistent with it. And, you know, for getting good looks from your teammates, go check out our videos that we made on how to get open. We dealt with things like the L cut, the V cut, the backdoor cut. There's a bunch of things that you can do to kind of create some space to get open looks. Right?
Right.
Well, and I think one of the biggest things about it is being in situations where you're not trying to work on that in gameplay, but working on that in practice, and especially in playing just pickup games or wherever, where you maybe take more risks in trying to get the ball to people. You're probably going to turn the ball over more, but you start practicing on how this situation might develop and how can I get them the ball, and I try to bounce pass it through to people, but it gets kicked out of bounds because I'm risking kind of bad passes. But you know, you don't want to develop a habit of that, but you want to practice of how can I learn this situation a little bit better and have the mentality that you are doing that within this situation.
Right.
Well, I think there's another element that's really important here too, and that is in that practice situation where you actually learn to keep your eyes up. The reason that we lose vision on the court is we're checking to see where the basketball is. And one of the things that I think is really important is that when you dribble a basketball, unless you're in a protection mode, is that you've got the ball kind of out and away from your body. And if you're using peripheral vision, most all of us, their field of vision is about 180 degrees. And so if I hold both my thumbs out, right directly out, except through Casey here, I can probably see both those thumbs and I'm looking straight ahead. And so we have that field of vision where that we don't really have to focus on something. We can, but we can focus generally and we can see the whole field. But it's just the thing I think is really important is that you have to practice this and just kind of get used to getting your head up and not worrying about where the basketball is. And the reason that you're looking for the basketball is because you have no confidence in your ball handling. When you develop that confidence, that you don't have to look at that ball.
Yeah, and you know, one thing I will say about the court vision thing is that to really have great court vision, you can't focus on something very directly. You need to have kind of a soft gaze where you're kind of just looking out in an area. You're not focusing on any one thing, because when you do that, you're able to see and kind of take in information from everywhere. When you're focusing in on one thing, it's really hard to have that peripheral vision.
It is. And it's so key, because you maybe bring the ball up court, and all of a sudden here comes a double team, and you're unaware of it until they're right on top of you. If you keep that head up, you can see that start to generate, and you can then make some other decision about what you're going to do. Go ahead, Chase.
Okay, next question.
Okay.
Chase. This one is from Allie with one L, who is at Allie is kind of funny on Twitter. They ask, when to take a charge, especially if the person is going at a quick speed. Greetings from the UK.
All right.
It's either Allie or Ali, but I don't okay. know.
Right. Hello to the UK.
Yeah, there's another person. Go spread the word.
Yeah.
When you're trying to take a charge, it's going to come down a little bit to experience, because you're going to have to be able to gauge if it's an opportune time to do it. If you're out of position and you try to do it, you're going to get called for the foul. If you have time to get in front of the person and establish your position, you should do that, because you're going to probably be able to generate a charge in that situation. But also, if you try to do it too early, then they're just going to go around you and you're going to look kind of silly. So it really does take experience and know when the correct time is to do that. Because there's times you can be too late and you can be too early.
Right, right. I agree with that.
Well, and I think kind of things are changing in the course of basketball as well. In recent years, I think charges are going away more and more. And I think you see that even with college, of putting in the circle. And you know, I think the offensive player always has the advantage, but even more so today than 10 years ago. And I think probably the biggest thing is you shouldn't be a mentality of I'm going to take a charge. It should be a mentality of I'm going to play great defense and be in the right position. And if for some reason somebody makes contact with me while I'm in the right position, then I can take that charge. But I think there's so much less of, you know, practicing taking a charge or working on I'm going to have both my hands in front of me and being over in front of the defender. I just see that going away more and more. It was very prominent when I was playing in high school and college, but I think that's going away more today. And just a lot of the basketball that I watch and even play in is just you see that not being as much of a focus as it was 10 years ago.
I agree with that on that, Chase. One of the other things that is kind of developing too, and we're probably going to see this come down, filter down more into the high school, is that offensive players are getting really crafty and avoiding those by using the Euro step. And some guys are so athletic, they can actually slip those. They go up and kind of turn their body a little and slip it. And what happens oftentimes when there's contact there, it shouldn't be called on the defense, but often is, just because officials don't really see it properly, I think. But just because players are more athletic and they have a chance to sidestep some of those screens, I think that's important to consider too. And I think Chase is right about how that's all in flux right now.
Right. I mean, I would totally agree with all that. And I think that really the key is getting in front of your guy, beating him to the spot. And if you're able to do that, you're going to stop him defensively. If he tries to go through you, that's where the charge is taken. Right. So if you are able to stay in front and beat them to their spots, then that's really going to put you in the best position all around. Okay, so let's go back to the Q&A. This one is from, let's see, Rodney Ty, who says, I can't shoot like I did before. For example, three-point shots. I only score 2 to 3 balls and several shots. And also, same condition as two-point shots. What can I do to improve my shooting skills? Okay. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, like we always say, the three pillars of practice, but probably the number one thing is work on your form shooting.
Yes.
And take all the fundamentals that we talk about in our videos, incorporate that into your mechanics. And first pillar of practice, diligent, slowed down, very practical approach to it.
Thoughtful, practical.
Yeah, diligent, thoughtful approach, where you're doing stuff like the form shooting drill. You're shooting at specific spots close to the basket using proper form. As soon as you master the close in, take a step back, shoot there, master that zone, scoot back, master that zone, and just work on that. Then take it to the next pillar, which is game speed, game intensity shooting, where you're stepping it up, you're shooting in more game-like situations, where maybe you even have a defender that's stepping in to play against you, or you're visualizing that, or you're coming off the shot, coming off the dribble. That's the second pillar. Third pillar is just getting out there and playing in games and getting the game experience using all of those mechanics and stuff like that. So that's really how you generate your shooting skills is doing that. And you can also check out Dennis Stanton's spin shooting workout that we talked about last week. You know, Dennis has a really good approach to this one inclusive workout for your shooting. So check that one out too.
Well, before we go away from that, you know, one of the terms that you used there was visualization. Chase, what do you think about utilizing that particular technique in learning how to play basketball?
Yeah, I mean, it's just a great supplement because you don't always have a court that you can go shoot at. I think the visualization, and there's tons of research that have actually shown that visualization is almost as effective as actual physical practice.
Right.
So I think it's a really important step to really begin to build your confidence in a situation, the kind of feeling of I've been there before and done this, even though you technically haven't, you've just really kind of thought in depth about it. I think it's really an important part of basketball and learning anything.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Next question. This one is from Fat Nguyen, who asks or says, "High Shot Science, really appreciate your work and passion for the game. Your channel and Hardwood Hustle podcast are the two channels I listen to all the time to learn new things and about the basketball world." Cool. I have a question. "I do shooting workouts 3 times a week. Should I practice different skills during one workout or try to master one drill before moving on to another? Also, how do you keep focusing on your shot when you get tired toward the end of your workout? A fan from Vietnam." Man, everybody is checking in from all over the world.
That's really cool.
So I'll take the practice one.
Go for it.
Based on scientific background, it's really important to have a kind of repetitive nature of drills. So you don't want to do one drill for an hour and then master it and then move on to something else. What you want to do is have a repetitive set of drills that you constantly touch on for small periods of time over a much more kind of longer chronological time period. So you should have a set of 5 to 6 drills that are always kind of your foundation of stuff that you're doing every time, and you're building on top of that. So a smaller, shorter window of time over a longer period, you're going to be much more effective than one drill and trying to master that at one period of time and then leaving it.
Well, and you might not come back to it for 3 or 4 days, and oftentimes we backslide a little bit when we do that, and backsliding means that your shot will become a little less effective if you're hitting it on a regular basis. And I think this is what Chase is getting at, is that we have this series of drills and we work on all of those drills every time that we work out, then we tend to retain a lot more of those elements of the shot.
Yeah, I mean, it's all about consistency. If you do all your shooting on Sunday and then you show up on Friday afternoon and you're trying to make all your shots, it's not going to be there.
Right.
So you want to have a consistent approach to your practice, and you want to have a nice variety to kind of make sure that you're hitting all the aspects of your skills.
Well, and even if you have 60 minutes to practice on something, you're going to be much better off spreading those 60 minutes over the course of 2 weeks than to try to get 60 minutes all at once. You're just not going to have as effective learning on that.
Well, and your concentration level begins to break down after a little while too. One of the last part of his question there, let's see, where is it?
Right here.
Okay, how to keep focusing on your shot when you're tired. You know, this is kind of the essence of what game speed shooting is all about. One of the things that we do when we go out and we just essentially are practice shooting, the intensity level is very low and we never really get very tired, and we start to get pretty sweet on the shot, it's falling for us. But then we get into that game situation where we're playing against other players, and we start to then have our shot not be so consistent because of defenders that you're not used to having. The fact that the speed of the game is much quicker when you get out on the floor and you're going 5-on-5 or even 1-on-1. And then finally, the thing that's really important too is to make sure that you understand that fatigue is a part of this game. And so when you go to work, you want to work at a tense level of speed, but you want to do it over a little more extended period of time where you get tired.
Well, here's
that's how you learn to shoot, is when you are fatigued, and it really counts. Like, let's say you've got 2 minutes to go in the game and you're down 6 points or whatever, and you're gassed, and you need to have that experience of what that feels like before you go out on the floor and do that. That's why game speed shooting is so important, and that, along with our video on consistent shooting, it all kind of addresses that. Chase, you wanted to say something too there, didn't you?
No, I think that's good.
Okay. Well, I mean, I was just going to say that it takes mental toughness to develop that kind of stuff. Yeah. You know, you have to push yourself when you get tired. That's why it's great to shoot free throws at different periods of time when you're working on your conditioning or working through a really intense game speed kind of workout. Because if you do that, you get down the stretch deep in the fourth quarter, you're gassed and you're trying to go up to the line and shoot some effective free throws, you're not going to just go up there and just be a total, you know, bomb. You know, you're going to get there and you're going to be a reliable shooter that's going to make shots in the clutch. And a lot of times you see players like, you know, like Ray Allen or even Derek Fisher. These are guys that are super conditioned and they can make shots at any point during the game. It's not like their accuracy tails off at any point. They've
not because of fatigue, it doesn't.
Yeah, yeah, because they've worked up the conditioning not only in their bodies but also in their shooting mechanics and just their all of overall skills. They've worked at those at different points of their conditioning.
Right.
Okay, next question. Let's go back to the chat here. This one is from Harris Romanovic, who says, when shooting, should you have the ball close to your body or not have the ball close to your body?
Any thoughts?
Well, I mean, you don't want to have it like pressed up against you, right, but you also don't want to have it. I mean, it's one of those happy medium things. You don't want to have it way out in front of you because that exposes it to the defense.
Well, here's the thing that probably will answer that a little more clearly. I remember that we were chatting with, I think, was it Denton Stanton the other day where we talked about the eye, the thumb over the eye?
Uh-huh.
Okay, where when you have the ball and ready to go, that you wanted to have the shooting thumb over your eye, whether it's your left eye or your right eye, didn't make any difference. But another thing that's really important, I'm going to just turn sideways here a little bit, Casey, slide over a little bit, is that when you have the ball in your set point, that the arm here represent the letter L. And you'll notice that that takes it away from your face about 6 to 8 inches. And that's really important, and it's important for this reason, is that you're more likely to elevate the basketball when you shoot it, which is what you really want to do. When this arm begins to get back close to your head or face like this or your body, notice that my arm turns into the letter V. And as it comes back to V, what happens is that as you shoot, this becomes a lever, and it's going to deliver a flat shot, which you don't want. So I would say that making sure you get that arm in the letter L probably will answer your question for you.
Yeah, and you also don't want to have it far out because you're, again, creating a situation where you're adding a variable. And, you know, that's more distance it has to go. That's another motion it has to go through. But if you're taking the ball from here and you're right here in this, and, you know, pulling it into where the shot starts, I mean, you're going to be in good shape. Okay. Let's see. This one is from Christian Eduardo Delgado Davila, who says, when a player is trying to tackle my defense, I usually can't avoid getting passed by the attacker. What exercise should I do? I play in pivot position. By the way, this is greetings from Ecuador. I think you were talking about another sport, buddy.
But nice to hear from you from Ecuador.
That sounds like
that's cool.
Some soccer or football. Let's see. This one is from Matthew Nacu, who says, why does my shot work in practice and street games but not in my actual game?
Okay.
We have a video about that, by the way.
Yes, we do.
But it comes back to the three pillars of practice and probably the last two that really apply to you. You need to get some game speed, game intensity practice going, so you're actually kind of putting yourself in the situation of the game in your practice. You can't just expect to go out there and have like a slow, diligent, or even casual approach to your shooting and then step out on the court and be able to perform that. You need to get the game speed, game intensity practice.
Well, the other thing that happens too, when you're playing in pickup games, there probably is not as much pressure that you put on yourself. But when you get into more organized games, you don't want to make a mistake. And so you become very unconfident in how you exhibit your game. And so that's an important part of it too.
And Matthew also asks, and how do I add arc on my shot?
Okay, we were just chatting about this just a moment ago, and let me just kind of turn here for a second. If you notice here, we like to have this arm represent the letter L, and the ball is up here in my palm. And as I'm going to shoot it, I'm going to elevate that elbow so that it finishes at a point higher than my eye level. And what happens is that when that elbow rises here, it's going to give you much more of a parabola or an arc on your shot, which is really important because When you have more of an arc on the basketball, that basketball get, or that net or the rim itself gets really big. Okay, when we shoot flat shots, it gets really small. If you're shooting a ball that just goes over the front rim and it does go in, you're shooting that 9.5-inch basketball. I'm thinking about the men's basketball. That's a diameter of the ball. That it is going into a hole in that basket. It's about the same size as the ball. And as soon as you get more arc on that shot, you'll find that now you're able to use a much larger landing area for your shot. So arc is really important, and that's how you get it.
Yep. Elevate your finish for sure. This one is from Khalid Abdallah, who says, does swaying help or does kicking out your legs help? No, it does not. And, you know, I mean, it's just another variable. It's not worth your time. Okay, this one is from YTV Kevin. How do you do a fadeaway that looks nice but you're not falling? I think that's not
a shot.
Yeah, I think that's a regular shot.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the thing about it is we don't like fadeaways because they are lower percentage shots. And the reason why is because you're adding in a variable, right? That variable is essentially that you're falling backwards. And anytime you add any kind of directionality to your body when you're shooting, you're going to have to compensate that for that in your shot, and you're in your power, and you're going to have to be falling away. And so that's another, you know, thing that can go wrong. And there's a reason why you're shooting that, and it's probably because you're contested. So it's probably not a good shot, to begin with. So work harder on creating space. That's really the key in a fadeaway, is not to shoot it.
But just create good space for getting your shot off.
Yeah. And I know people don't like to hear that because they like the way the fadeaways look. But the fact of the matter is, would you rather score a ton of points shooting great shots, or would you rather score a few points shooting fadeaways? Okay. This one is from Source Serif, who asked, how do I guard smaller guys on the perimeter? Just like we were talking about earlier, it's really just about getting in front of them, beating them to the spot.
Go ahead, Chase.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're trying to keep them between your shoulders at all times.
Yeah.
And with smaller, quicker guys, that sometimes can be a little bit more difficult. But you want to really focus in, kind of, blur your vision a little bit, but really focus in on their body. What are some of the different area points? I usually focus in on like their, not their belt buckle, but kind of a diffuse view of that central area. Because it's much harder to fake with that area of your body without getting off balance.
Right.
And then really just try to keep them between your shoulders and knees at all times. Right. One of the things that I really focus in on when defending on the perimeter as well is if you're just squared up to them, a lot of times it's very difficult to guard both directions, or you allow the offensive player to change directions very easily. So one of the things I like to do is be able to kind of put my center of my body over where the ball is.
Yep.
And try to keep a hand in the middle of their midsection. So anytime they try to change the ball from one side to the other, I'm constantly going to be challenging that ball, and it takes them time to get from spot to spot. The more you back up and give them space, the more they can do whatever they want. So I think it's important to really pressure them, not be too close, but to keep the arms distance away. And you always want to keep that arms distance, but to keep your body over the center of the ball and force them to have the ball on one side of their body or the other. When it's right in the middle, they can go either way. But if you pressure them enough where they have to turn and move the ball from one side, and when they bring it across, they're getting challenged, and now they have to have it on the other side, I think you have much more control as a defender. It's a much more aggressive play than just standing 3 feet off and letting them do whatever they want.
Yeah, and you can go check out Chase explaining that with demonstrations and everything in his Defense 101 videos. There's two videos where he talks about all those things.
Right. One of the other things that happens to defenders is that oftentimes after the offensive player has got an aggressive step, they kind of hesitate. When you've got to shuffle your feet to stay in front of them, and if they get that lead on you, then you've got to turn your body and you've got to sprint and try to reestablish your position in front of them. What I see oftentimes is that somebody will get a little bit of a head of a defender, and the defender, more or less, he just decides, okay, I'm beat, I'm just going to trail him. And those who are really tough defenders, they'll try to outrun you and try to reestablish that position. And your constant presence there alongside of them while you're trying to do that is not easy for them to deal with.
Right. Right. Okay, this one is from, well, it just ended abruptly, so I was like caught off guard. Okay, this one is from Matthias Basket, who says, how do I do an easy jump shot like Michael Jordan? I play his position too. Okay, well, like we've been talking about the whole time, it's really about having an efficient shot. A lot of people say, I want to shoot like Ray Allen, I want to shoot like Steph Curry, and blah, blah, blah. What you really want to do is you want to take the fundamental aspects of shooting mechanics, use those, and build your own shot. You don't want to try to be like anybody else because you probably don't have their body type. They might have come about their mechanics differently than you will. You want to start with the bare bones stuff and kind of build it up to what works best for you. So, you don't want to necessarily be or look like Michael Jordan when he's doing all these things. Be the you that's going to be the most effective player, because that's really what you want to do. It's all about putting the ball in the basket, not looking like Michael Jordan. Yeah. So what you want to do is really work on having an efficient shot where you eliminate all the variables that don't need to be there. Work on connectivity and get tons of repetitions. Work on diligent form shooting, game speed, game intensity practice, and game experience.
Yep.
Right?
That is it. Yep.
Okay. Let's see. This one is from Josh Barr, who says, hey, coach, I've seen players use dip rhythm while shooting free throws. Any thoughts?
Well,
why?
I can't see any reason why you need to do that. I have seen people take and do this as they get, and this is the kind of dipping you're talking about. And that they use as kind of a rhythm maker. But here's what I find is that may tend to really kind of screw up your shot. Thing that I think is really important as you get ready to shoot that free throw is get it to your set point. And if your set point happens to be right here at about chin level, then that's where you go. And if you're shooting from up here, that's where you want to start from. You don't want to take and get into these variables that Casey's talking about a while ago. Any little variable in there is going to affect your total accuracy. I have had a couple of players in the last few days who have that little hitch. They come up and they're shooting free throws and they get ready to go and then they go, this little bounce right here, this little reset, and usually their accuracy isn't good. As soon as we set up and we get that thing stable, and we deliver the ball from there, they're usually much more accurate.
Well, and you don't really need to dip. I mean, I think that's the biggest thing.
Yeah.
Dipping is not needed at any point in basketball. No. With enough practice, you can learn how to remove a lot of those unnecessary movements, especially in free throws. You're already establishing your rhythm because there's no time structure to it. You have pretty much as long as you want to be able to set your shot up. So you set your rhythm up, your consistency up, just based on the mechanics as well.
Yes.
As maybe dribbling twice and getting right into your shot. But you want to set your rhythm up mentally, not with changing your shot. So start throwing off when you're actually shooting in the game of it. So just taking rid of dip rhythm out of everything is probably the most effective.
I agree with that one. One of the things that I often have discussion with shooters on is that one of the things that you don't want to do is to add anything in that stroke, like we talked a while ago, just a jump shot or whatever. We want to take and get stabilized, and we want to shoot that same shot 1,000 times. And that's where accuracy on the free throw begins to come in, is that we've got that nice, clean, very thorough shot, and we do it over and over and over and over and over.
Yeah.
Hundreds, thousands of times.
I mean, the more simple and pared down and efficient you are, the more repeatable it is, the more repeatable, the more accurate.
Yep.
And, the thing about free throws is that you're able to establish rhythm without anybody influencing you defensively or whatever. You have all the time in the world, or 10 seconds or whatever it is.
Right.
But, you're able to do that through dribbling and also your feet. You're able to move your feet, so 1, 2, and you're able to generate there. So you don't want to add something extra in to make it more complicated.
Well,
complication is hard to repeat.
There's another little thing that I think goes along with this as well, is that
okay, hurry up.
Okay, don't rush me. Your brain and your eyes are really a kind of computer. And as you bring your head up and you look at that that target, your brain, however it's doing it, I can't tell you, but it is really looking at that distance and figuring about how much force that we're going to have to apply to that basketball to get it there effectively. And so if we add some of these other things to it, for example, this little hitch, here I'm ready to go. My eyes are on the target. My brain is really dialed in. And then I change all that. well, momentarily the brain is kind of at a loss as to what we're going to do. And so then we go ahead and shoot, and we don't have the right focus. We don't have the right distance. We don't have the right arc. And so by coming up and setting yourself and looking at that basket right there, you kind of set the pattern for your shot with that.
Okay, we got a ton of questions. We have – this is lightning round, and I'm not joking around this week. Like, we need to keep these short, okay? This one is from Khalid Abdallah again, who asks, how do I gain coaches' trust from Germany? There's another country. Awesome.
Practice. Yeah. Practice.
Gain your coaches' trust, yes, through practice, just being reliable. You know, you're able to repeat the successes that you have, you know, all the time. You're not a wild card.
Being a good leader, always being the first, being
showing
hustling.
Showing effort, initiative. Go check out our Make the Team video, and that shows you all the things that coaches look for.
Yeah.
And also, I think Casey Hill, the coach for the Santa Cruz Warriors, he's done some videos with us on tryouts and stuff like that, and he talks a lot about like things that coaches look for in there too, so go check those out as well. Let's see. This one is from Okagbu09. Butchered that, but okay. How do you position your shots so you're not stripped in the motion of shooting, Benji? One would be not dipping the ball.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that we don't think about very much when we dip the ball is the fact that that defender is right there in front of you, and their arms are able to be very active when you shoot. And if, in fact, I would be instructing my guys that if you've got somebody who can dip the basketball, I'm going to take and have him spearing you in the chest with that near hand or the close hand, so that when you bring that ball up, it's going to be out on the floor. Go ahead.
Lightning.
Okay. Yeah. I know.
Oh, wait, where was it? Now I'm lost. Oh, great. Okay, yeah. This one is from Jean Dagan, who says, how can I know if my shot form slash release is right? Thanks. Number one, take a video of yourself. Look at it. Does it look right? I mean, you just want to make sure you're adding all the elements in there that we talk about in our videos. If you also want us to check it out, send us that video on Facebook or wherever, and we'll take a look at it.
Right.
Okay, this one is from Samuel Mesele, who says, should I use my legs more than my arms or the opposite?
Legs.
Legs, always. That's where the power is.
Where you generate the power. Those are the biggest muscles in your body. Okay, this one is also from John Dagan, who says, at what point do I release the shot?
At the end of your arm. You know, often, and I know that sounds kind of silly, but so often we have players who will do this kind of thing, and they'll kind of hitch back. And, the ball's always going to be short there. But when you get out to the end of your arm and you follow through with that wrist, that's going to be the best position for you on that shot.
I think he's meaning
it. I think on the jump.
Oh, the jump.
So just before you reach the arc.
Okay. Just as you are reaching the top, the ball needs to be on its way. If it's not, if you hesitate even for a moment there, the shot is going to be short.
Because you're underpowered. You've lost the power.
You're underpowered. You need to catch the power from the legs. As you're reaching the top, it's on the way.
Go check out our video. What's the I think it's the release point for the jump shot.
That's right. Yeah.
Excuse me. Okay. This one is from Kyle Means or Menez, who says, after you cross over, how would you set your shot without fading away? That's easy. I mean, you're essentially doing the same thing you would do coming off the dribble of any dribble attack or anything like that. And what you want to do is make sure that last bounce is a real rocket, bring it up to your hands, and go straight up into your shot.
Right.
I mean, it's still the 1-2 footwork. You know, the ball is going to gather it up with your offhand. I mean, it's all the same mechanics.
Yeah, that's the beautiful part about the crossover is being able to cross and get right into a shot 1-2. And you got to really work on the footwork of that. But the thing is once you beat somebody with that move a few times and you're not hopping into it, you go 1-2, they're going to get ready to get up for the shot, and you can cross right back over on them again and be able to pull up on an even more open shot. So the 1-2 is hugely important.
Going right and countering left, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, well, I'm talking about you catch the ball or you're dribbling and you cross over and you take 1-2, get ready to go up in your shot, and the defender has seen that a couple times from you, and so they're already off their feet, unbalanced. You can very easily cross right back over and counter in that move. That's why the 1-2 is so important over the hop,
right,
is that you can still counter on that. So that gives you that opportunity.
Right.
Okay. Lightning round. This one is from Henry Charley, I guess. He says, do you guys know anything I can do to speed up how I shoot and speed up my crossover? Okay, if you want to learn how to speed up your shot, we talked about that in the first 15 minutes or so of this video, so you can just watch the recording. It's also in all of our shooting videos, we pretty much talk about how to have an efficient shot, so check those out. In terms of speeding up your crossover, I think really making it more efficient too, and not having any kind of large swinging out movements of the ball, keeping it really compact and short, knee to knee type of stuff, keeping the dribble low. I mean, is there anything else you can really think of?
Practicing a lot and then challenging yourself at game speed and challenging yourself until you lose the ball.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things that we use in the way of instruction on any of these dribble attacks is that the first thing you need to do is really attack the defender hard. So they have to defend hard. And as you're able to get them to defend really hard, they set themselves up for your counter move. So that would be a flat back attack or whether it be a crossover or whatever. So you have to make them defend hard. If they don't defend hard, you go right on by them and get to the basket.
Right, okay. This one is from Samuel Meslay, who asks, how can I have a quick jump shot? All the stuff that we talked about, it's all the same stuff. It's about having an efficient shot. So check out those in our shooting videos. Okay, this one is from Magic B-Ball 98, who I've seen here before. Awesome to have you back. This one, he says, I have bad vision. Should I wear prescription goggles or contacts for basketball? I've worn contacts since I was in like 8th grade. I swear by contacts. I don't think I could wear prescription goggles, but I mean, I think it's up to the person.
Whatever's going to give you better vision.
Yeah, whatever's the most comfortable, really.
Yeah. I wore those goggles when I was a kid. Now, that's a different time, and so I think probably Casey's right. Probably the contacts are a better way to go.
I mean, contacts are a little funky to get used to, but once you do, I mean, I don't even think about it anymore. Okay, so let's see. Let's take maybe two or three more questions. This one is from Matthias Basket again, who says, I'm 5'5", and as I said, I'm a shooting guard, but I can't shoot three-pointers, so how do I do it?
Well, one of the things I think that is
lightning
really,
round.
Well, okay, I have to take this. And one of the things I think is really important is the fact that basketball has given these titles to these positions, and they're not really all that important. What you're going to do as a shooting guard probably is the same thing who's going to be a three guard and off guard. You're both probably going to be shooting the ball and attacking the basket and doing everything else you do in basketball. I just think that the idea of a shooting guard designation is really kind of unfounded. What you want to think about first is be a good basketball player and not worry about what position it is that you're playing in. Because in the very end product, what's going to happen if you're on a team, the guy that's coaching that team is going to tell you where he wants you to play. I know in our system that we've had for a long time, we give the guys numbers, but it has nothing to do with them being designated as a shooting guard.
And get your legs into it.
Yeah.
Check out our videos on that. That'll help you on that one. Okay, let's do some Twitter ones real quick. This one's from @NateT_AF again. He says, thanks, guys. And do you think colleges look at your height and weight when looking to recruit you? Does that stuff matter to them?
Yes.
It does in part. But obviously, who you are as a player and stuff really counts probably too.
And Chase probably has some good thoughts on this too. But I think they're looking at specific players and body size and types to fit into the offense and where they want to play you. They're not likely to take a 5'10 guy who's really quick and play him at the post. And likewise, they're not going to take that post guy who's, even though he might be quick and can shoot, they're not going to put him at the point guard position. Chase, you must have some thoughts on that one.
I mean, they're just looking for the best players, really. Yeah. It doesn't matter if you're 5'2". I mean, obviously, if you're 5'2" and slow, you're probably not going to be a good fit for playing college basketball. Yeah. But, they're just looking for the best players out there. Right. So size, height, weight, it matters, but it doesn't really matter. What really matters is who the best players are and who can use the physical skills they have.
Right.
Okay, here's some quick ones right here. This one is from Ali, who is at Ali is kind of funny again. How should I drive straight to the basket? I tend to fade away as soon as the defender stands in my way in between my two steps. I think you just need to work on going north-south instead of looping out and going east-west. You have to want the contact. Your hips and shoulders to seal the guy.
And you have to not be afraid of contact.
Yep.
Oftentimes when young players go to the basket, they're afraid. I had a young girl the other day
lightning.
And I know it's lightning, but I asked her why she didn't like to drive, and she just said, I don't know. And I said, well, yeah, you do know. And she said, well, I don't like the contact. Okay. All right, I know, guys. And so you have to learn to get over that. And it's not like something like you're going to be injured and have to have the ambulance come and pick you up at all. Okay, guys, go for it.
All right, Captain Anecdote. Okay, let's see. This one is from, let's do two more. This one's from Samuel Mesley. He says, should I flick my wrist more often? Okay, I hate it when people say flick your wrist because that implies like a certain amount of tension that you're going to be putting into your release. You want your release to be a very relaxed flop finger finish where it's essentially just flopping over the top of your wrist here. If you're doing things like snapping and pointing and doing all this stuff, you're adding tension to your shot, which will make you less accurate. So what you want to do is just be very relaxed, have the ball flop off of those fingers. And if you watch guys shoot in slow motion on those NBA Phantom Cam stuff, you can see their hand just flops over the top and their hand just kind of bounces a little bit like that. And that's because they are so relaxed, they are not putting a snap or anything like that into
right.
it.
Right, and a big part of that is you don't want all the extra rotation from snapping that wrist. You want that ball to be soft, and so when you flop it, it tends to slow that rotation down.
Okay, last question. This one is from John Dagan, who says, what can I do in the summer to improve my accuracy? Thanks for your help. It helps a lot. Regards from Israel. Everybody is here today.
Yeah, this is so cool.
Yeah, and if you're from those places, go spread the word. We would love that.
Yeah.
Okay, what can I do in the summer to improve my accuracy? You just have to consistently shoot, get tons of repetitions in. I mean, that's really what it is.
Well, and make sure it's the right repetitions. One of the things that you'll find is some players are not consistent with what they do in their shooting. Look at our videos and see if they're going to help you and get that motion down, and then do it so much that it's a matter of muscle memory. You don't really have to think about it consciously, and that's when your shot's going to start to improve for you. And plus, also, we talked about the game speed shooting. That's really important as well.
Right. Okay. So that's going to do it for us today, you guys. If we didn't get to your questions, it's not because we didn't like you. It's because we just ran out of time and we had a bunch of questions. We will try to get back to you if we can. If you want us to answer your questions, definitely tweet them to us. We are at Shot Science, or you can send them to us, in a video that's appropriate for your topic. And we will try to get back to you guys during the week. If you want to come back, I think we're going to be off next week, off next Sunday, and we'll be back the following Sunday after that. So make sure you kind of are subscribed to everything, and then you'll be able to find us when we have our next show. Let's see. Make sure you follow us. We are at Shot Science on Twitter. Follow us on Facebook. We are Shot Science there. Google+, we are Shot Science there. We have a lot of cool stuff there every day. And subscribe to us on YouTube. You can also follow Chase on Twitter. He is at Chase Curtis, right? So if you have questions for him, he's another great resource to hit up. And I guess, does anybody have anything else they want to say?
No. Have a good day, and thanks for joining us today. That's very cool, especially from all corners of the earth.
Yeah, that was awesome. We'll see you guys later. All right.